Good afternoon, Justice Peralta. I hope your eye is better now. I understand that you requested more time for your some of your exams because you are recovering from an eye operation.
I have a laser operation on my right eye, and at the same time, a operation on my cataract. But before that, I had also similar operation, so my reading glass is adjusting after that operation. So I have a hard time reading small letters, Your Honor. Well, but I'm all right now.
Okay, thank you. Justice. Now, let me ask my first question. First, among the aspirants for the position of Chief Justice, you have the most number of cases resolved over the past 5 years, a total of 3,895. Your average monthly output is 104.4 cases, and your percentage of cases disposed of is a high 110.59%. Now, how will you encourage your fellow members in the court to speedily resolve their pending cases, especially those who are unable to match your output?
You know, thank you for that information, ma'am. Now, firstly, I would like to say that when I joined the court in 2009, that was January 2009, I had the most number of cases that inherited. I had only one, I had 1,300 cases. And most of those cases were submitted for decision. Therefore, I had to resolve them through extended resolutions and extended decisions. Of course, you also receive cases on a yearly basis, and then we receive something like 650 cases a year. So if you add up the cases that I received and the cases that inherited, probably it will end up to something like 7,000 cases. So I probably have reduced my docket to only 300 cases. Therefore, I resolved something like 6,500 to 6,800 cases for the almost 10 years that I've been in the court. Now, my colleagues have their own way of resolving their cases, Your Honor. They are aware also of the output that we have because we are also furnished outputs. And the only way, probably, the help that I can give is to advise them that they should also adopt ways and means in order to reduce their dockets. That's only what I can do because we cannot teach them what they're supposed to do because they have their own way of resolving their cases, Your Honor.
Thank you, Justice. Now, should you be nominated and appointed as Chief Justice, you will be serving for 3.5 years. And you stated in your essay proposals that you have made. You stated something as with regard to, on page 3, on corruption, to adopt, and I quote, the old principle that the Supreme Court applied before res ipsa loquitur. Where the decisions of a lower court judge clearly acted partially to a litigant to the extent of violating existing rules and jurisprudence. Even if there is no proof of corruption, the court should initiate a complaint on the ground of gross ignorance of the law, end of quote. How aggressive has the court been in initiating motu proprio, requiring a judge to explain a decision rendered on grave abuse of discretion or even gross ignorance of the law, and or how aggressive should it be?
I will explain first before I answer that question why I said that we had to apply the old principle of rep ipsa loquitur. Probably during the time of your father, I read a lot of cases where judges were penalized applying the principle of res ipsa loquitur. The problem with litigants and lawyers is that even if they sense that a judge might have been corrupted in order to favor the adverse party, they do not come to us and file a complaint. They do not execute any verified complaint. Or even the lawyers, they do not come to us and complain about a judge who has been corrupted. Now, if you apply the res ipsa loquitur, if the cases are brought to us and we can sense, and we can sense that the judge misapplied the law in order to favor another one, probably we can initiate the complaint no longer based on corruption, but based on gross ignorance of the law. And we have applied that, those principle in so many cases. I think, I do not want to mention one, but the latest is an RTC judge somewhere in Metro Manila, where there were insinuations of corruption, but nobody can come up with evidence of corruption. So what we did was to apply the principle of res obsolicitor, because from the decision itself, something wrong was done to favor the other party.
Thank you, Justice. I understand that now the court administrator takes note of even anonymous complaints which would initiate judicial audit. However, I understand that there are only a few audit teams. How will you address this apparent lack of sufficient personnel to address the need to constantly monitor the cases of lower court judges?
Thank you, Your Honor. Thank you for asking that question. Because I've always been in constant communication with the court administrator, because I myself receive information about judges who have been committing wrongdoings while in office. And I told him that the best way to catch a judge probably is not doing properly is to conduct inventory on their cases. And we had many, there were many judges where their dockets were inventoried, and we really found out that they were doing wrongdoings now. But the problem really is there is lack of auditors or personnel to conduct the inventory. So my suggestion, because we are limited, we have limitations, we cannot just employ personnel without violating existing civil service rules. Well, I think what they can do is to adopt the system that what they are doing now on contractual stenographers, because there is a dearth of stenographers. Every now and then we have a lack of stenographers. We have now adapted the employment of stenographers on a contractual basis. I think we can also do that in the OCA, probably employ contractual employees to help the OCA in conducting inventory of cases or even conducting audit on this courtsman, Your Honor.
Thank you, Justice. Now, you have been a strong proponent of continuous trial, especially in drugs-related cases, and ever since the implementation, you have been actively going around the country to promote and to explain the rules on continuous trial. What is the assessment on the effectivity of continuous trial in criminal cases? Because in your essay, you propose that it be extended to civil cases, and there is also a feedback that the resolution of civil cases has been hampered due to the concentration of the courts in continuous trial of criminal cases.
Well, I will, you will allow me a long answer, because in my essay, I just said that we had to continue with the continuous trial. First, ma'am, we implemented the continuous trial nationwide on September 1 of 2017. And we have already validation reports from the MISO and also from the OCA. They just submitted to me the report last July. And it seems that there is a considerable reduction of cases in criminal cases. And one of the reasons is because of the continuous trial in criminal cases. But we are failing in drug cases. It's good the good senator is here. We are failing in drug cases because in drug cases, the law says that we have to terminate the trial of drug cases within 60 days from the filing of the information. It is humanly impossible to come up with a termination of a criminal case when you start the counting of the period from the filing of the information. It should start after the arraignment. That's number one. We are also failing in the promulgation of decisions in so far as drug cases also, because judges are required to promulgate the decisions within 15 days from submission, and they have a hard time. Now, The idea actually, ma'am, of continuous trial is this, no? We develop the skills of judges. We never change the rules. We never amended the rules. We just develop the skills of judges and also remind the judges what they are supposed to do because they are covered by different rules. Now, the other thing is that in order to comply with the agreementary periods, what we usually do is that during arraignment, the judge should now schedule the hearing or the reception of the evidence of both the prosecution and the accused. So that will be the schedule that will be followed by the judge from beginning up to the end now. When it comes to drug cases, the judges cannot do that. Why? If they will schedule the trial of cases during arraignment, then it will happen that most of the cases will be scheduled within the 60 days, and there will be 6 or 7 cases scheduled on the same day. And they cannot hear cases more than 3 per day. So that's our problem in the dangerous drug. But as I said, ma'am, all in all, if I be allowed to look at my records, for the information also of the public, for RTC, that means the first level courts, compliance with the reglementary period for criminal cases cognizable by the RTC, they are supposed to terminate their cases within 180 days. You may be shocked, ma'am, that the regional trial court was only 1.12% compliant with the 180-day period. But when we implemented the continuous trial, the compliance now is 44.48% for the regional trial court. For the family court, their compliance was only 1.83% for the 180 days. Now it is 26.53%. Of course, in family courts, the prior lady, you cannot really comply with the 80-day period because there are many things that you should do in family courts. For METC, that means Metropolitan Trial Court, compliance was only 2.94%. After we implemented the continuous trial, it's now 54.56%. For MTCC, it was 3.20%. Now it is 53.04%. For MTC, that means the Municipal Trial Court, it used to be 2.35%, now it's 54.34%. For MCTC, it was merely 2.69%, 53.96%. The average then is that before we applied the continuous trial, it was only 2.36%, now it is 47.82%. In promulgation of decisions where we are required by the Constitution, the Second Labor Court should promulgate decision within 90 days. I will not anymore mention the individual percentages of the courts. Before, it was only 37.75%. In other words, there were only 37.75% complying with the 90-day period. Now, we have 68.56%. We will have a better improvement the next year because when we implemented the continuous trial on September 1, there were already cases scheduled for trial, and they can already be disturbed because lawyers have already been informed beforehand. But after 1 year of implementation, we expect a better improvement next year, and with the cooperation of Congress to amend some laws to help us in reducing the dockets of the court. I hope they will soon also amend some laws to help us in reducing the dockets of this court. Now, yes, ma'am, just one lang. Now. I wrote in my essay that if we can adopt continuous trial in criminal cases, why can we not adopt continuous trial in civil cases? That's why I said that if it is successful, then probably in the next 2 or 3 years, we can adopt a system of continuous trial likewise in civil cases. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Judge. Just a follow up. You mentioned that the levels, and that you have seen the remarkable increase
yes,
in the compliance. But what is the target of the court, in terms of compliance percentages, and how do you plan to increase the compliance ability of our courts?
Yeah. As we always do in the Supreme Court, that before we implement our rules, we have our own technical working group. No, we go around and they determine why is it that they cannot comply. So when I receive this report only this month, I will seek permission from the court that we will again go around and convene my members of the technical working group and the subcommittee, and then go around why we have this accomplishment. Probably, I know that we can increase. But of course, there are many reasons. One is we have problems on number of personnel. We have problems on the availability of prosecutors. We have problems on availability of stenographers. We have a lot of problems. But we expect an improvement. I'm confident that by next year we have a better result, ma'am. That I can assure, ma'am.
Thank you, thank you, Justice. Senator Gordon, if I may just have two more points, please. Okay, thank you. Let me adopt some questions from the proposed questions from the Supreme Court Appointments Watch. You are now third in the order of seniority among the members of the Supreme Court. What is your opinion on applying the seniority rule in the appointment of a Chief Justice?
When we talk of seniority, that means that I am senior starting from the acting acting Chief Justice, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
But insofar as applicants is concerned, I'm the second, because we are only three applicants and Justice Tess is second on the ranking. So if you base the ranking on the applicants, I'm second to the more senior, ma'am. Well, seniority really plays an important role in the choice of a Chief Justice. There are many things that a justice should learn. Many things. I came from the regional tri-court and then from the San Diego. I was a fiscal. I thought that I know already the job of a justice. But it's not. You have to learn from experience, no? I cannot say that I'm already the best or I know already the work of a Chief Justice. I have still to learn some. So seniority plays an important role. But seniority sometimes may not be the number one factor. There are still many factors to consider. So that is my opinion, ma'am.
Thank you, Justice. And my final question. You submitted your SAL ends for the past 10 years. And let me just state that we noted increases starting 2012, significant, that is. From 2012 to 2013, it was an increase of 3 million. From 2013 to 2014, an increase of another 3 million. From 2014 to 2015, I'm speaking in terms of net worth, okay? From 2014 to 2015, it's up by 4 million. From 2015 to 2016, it's up another 4 million. And finally, from 2016 to 2017, it's another 5 million. Could you inform the council? Yeah, perhaps you can enlighten us on.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you that you asked that question. My SAL end is a joint filing of my wife. It's a joint filing, actually. Now, the sources of income reflected there and the income of my wife will justify the increase of the SAL end, ma'am. Now, in 2012, there was a last increase of our salary based because of the law on the, I think, RA 9227, SADS law. Because there was an advance of salary from 2007, there were allowances that we received 2007 to 2010 based on the SAL end law. And they became part of our salary. Then we came up with a resolution in 2012 that even if we have already increased the salaries and then incorporate the SAL end allowance into our basic pay, we ruled that we have to continue receiving our allowance under our SAL end law. Number two, ma'am, is that In 2011, I became a member of the House of Representative Electoral Tribunal. And I think it is reflected there, the compensation that I received. The compensation that I receive yearly, I think, is 1.7 million. And you add that to the salary that I receive from the Supreme Court and the allowance that I get from the PET, and including those honoraria that I receive from my lectures, either spearheaded by the Philippine Judicial Academy and other institutions, then you get an increase of the SALEN. Now, in 2014, I was the chairman of the bar examinations. No? I do not know how much I received, but I can recall it could have been more than 1.7 million. No? And continuously receiving SAL allowances from the HRET, the same amount that I received in 2012, and also the allowances that I received from my PET, include that my basic pay from the Supreme Court and my allowances, including the salary allowances of my wife. I think that will explain why there was an increase of 3 million. Also in 2017, it was a gift from God, a bonus from God, because I did not know that I was already entitled to a lump sum pension from the SSS, because when I first worked, when I was 20 years old, I worked in a private company and I was a member of the SSS. And when I became a lawyer in 2001, I was still connected with a private company. In 1982, I started teaching in the University of Santo Tomas, again, member of the SSS. Then when I joined the faculty of the Ateneo College of Law in 2005, I again received SSS. So when I reached the age of 65, I was wondering, what happened to my contribution in the SSS? So it so happened that I met my good friend, the former chairman, the Dean Amadio Valdez, and I asked him, am I entitled to a lump sum? And he said, of course, yes, you are supposed to be entitled to a lump sum when you reach the age of 60 and you have already paid 120 monthly contributions. So why should you not apply? The reason why I received an amount almost 1 million in November of 2017, which has included as an additional income, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you. That you asked that question, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Justice. As I mentioned, that was my last question. Thank you.
Thank you also, ma'am.
Thank you, Senator Gordon.
Thank you, Attorney Cayosa. We shall now hear from Judge Ilo.
Thank you, Senator Gordon. It's already good afternoon, Justice Diosdado Madarang Peralta.
Good afternoon, also, Your Honor.
When I was in a private practice in the 70s, there was a city court judge by the name of Madarang in Manila.
That's my uncle, Your Honor. That's the brother of my mother, Rufino Madarang.
Okay. Yeah.
I had a lot of relatives, Your Honors.
You were 39 years old when you had your first child. Why did you start late?
Yeah, okay. I hope Justice Callejo is listening, Your Honor. I will answer it this way, you know. And this is a true story. I was married to my job. I never thought that I would get married.
Where's Justice
Callejo? Because Justice Callejo did not allow me to take a rest when I was his prosecutor. When I was his prosecutor from 1988 up to 1994, he never allowed me to have a rest except lunchtime. And we had to hold trial from 8:30 to 12 o'clock, and then 2 o'clock to 4:30 in the afternoon. And the only time that we have a recess is during lunchtime. But it was providential, Your Honor, that when I was already 37 years old, or almost 36 years old, for the first time, he told me, and he asked me, Fiscal, can we have a break? Then I told him, granted, Your Honor. So I went out of the courtroom. I went around the courtroom and I met a solicitor, assistant solicitor general in one of the courtrooms where they usually start their trial at 10 o'clock. Then there's where I met my wife, Your Honor. And so I got married late. It was about 6 days short of becoming 37 years old. And unfortunately, the first pregnancy of my wife was a blighted ovum. So I thought that we will not bear any more children, but God's will, or through prayers, Your Honor, we had 4 children now. The first pregnancy was a girl, the second pregnancy, twins. And then I have a young boy who's only 15 years old. But no regrets, Your Honor, no regrets.
No 1-year-old boy?
14-year-old.
Ah, 14, sorry.
15-year-old.
Already they have a defect in hearing. At any rate, you attended the study tour on court automation in Washington, D.C. and Virginia. Have you implemented any project for court automation after that?
Yes, that's a good question, Your Honor. Now, the seminar that we attended was a seminar for judges, I think, and also justices, no? But at that time, when we attended that seminar, there was no yet automation to speak up. We were being prepared to attend. No, not fully automated. May I ask, Your Honor, what year was that? Because there are many troubles that I had in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, during the time that you had traveled, no, no, that's not indicated on record.
Yes, Your Honor. So if that was the time that we were in Sandigan Bayan, I think it was Sandigan Bayan that first introduced automation to the information of everybody, Your Honor. We had the first automated, I think, we introduced it in Sandigan Bayan during the term of Justice Tess de Castro. So we were required to attend that seminar. Automation really helped, Your Honor, because that will replace the manual taking down of notes by taking down the testimony of witnesses through the computer. If you want a correction, if you want to know what is the statement of the witness, you just rely on what is printed or what is taken by the computer. That will really expedite termination of cases, Your Honor.
News reports say that you are close to Justice Lucas Bersamin. And in fact, there are several photos of you together in different social media. How does it feel going against the top post with your close friend as an applicant for the position of Chief Justice of the Supreme Court?
That's a good question, Your Honor, but I will start answering a question during our RTC days in Quezon City. What happened is that I was unknown to Justice Bersamin, but he was older by 3 years, I think, by me. And he was his station was Branch 96, and my station was Branch 95. So the rooms were beside each other. And because of what I experienced from Judge Caliejo, so I applied for the experience. So I do not go out from my courtroom. Justice Bersamin also does not go out from his courtroom. So we always take lunch together. And there were humors, they would say, sino ba sa kanila sa dalawa? That started the friendship. But you know, Your Honor, when we meet on lunchtime, we discuss jurisprudence. Because he's an expert in procedure, and he considers me also good in criminal procedure and criminal law. And we make exchanges. Now, about competition with two friends, I recall, when I applied for the position of Sandigan Bayan, and Justice Bersamin applied for the Court of Appeals, a question was asked by the former Chief Justice, are you not competing with each other? He said, no, sir, because he's applying for the Court of Appeals, I'm applying for the Sandigan Bayan now. We have many things in common, actually, because during our time as RTC judges, he was chosen, no? I hope I'm not selling him. But he was chosen as an astounding judge for best decision in writing in 2000, both in criminal law and civil law. So they were saying, oh, talo ka nung friend mo. Sabi ko, he's better than I, so why should I envy him? And you know what happened the next year? I was chosen as one of the outstanding judges during the 100th year celebration of the Supreme Court. And the next year, we were both outstanding judges in judicial excellence. I was appointed, I think, in the year 2002 to the Sandigan Bayan, he was also appointed to the Court of Appeal in the same year. I was appointed in the Supreme Court, January of 2009. He was appointed April of 2009 as a Justice of the Supreme Court. Now that there is a vacancy of justice, so we are here again. Whoever we be appointed, Your Honor, we have to respect. I see him as a competent and ready to assume the position of the Chief Justice. I hope that is the same way he feels about me. So that's my answer, Your Honor.
And why should you be chosen over your colleagues, Justice?
How is that, Your Honor?
Why should you be chosen over your colleagues? We have this Associate Justices, Teresita de Castro, because Bersamin.
Oh, yeah, I will.
About Andres Reyes Jr.
I cannot speak about Justice Andy Reyes because he has only been with the Supreme Court for less than a year. But I can talk about Justice Tess de Castro and Justice
Bering. At any rate, you attended the study tour on court automation in Washington, D.C. and Virginia. Have you implemented any project for court automation after that?
Yes, that's a good question, Your Honor. Now, the seminar that we attended was a seminar for judges, I think, and also justices, no? But at that time, when we attended that seminar, there was no yet automation to speak up. We were being prepared to attend. No, not fully automated. May I ask, Your Honor, what year was that? Because there are many troubles that I had in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, during the time that you had traveled, no, that's not indicated on record.
Yes, Your Honor. So, if that was the time that we were in Sandigan Bayan, I think it was Sandigan Bayan that first introduced automation to the information of everybody, Your Honor. We had the first, automated, I think, we introduced it in Sandigan Bayan during the term of Justice Tess de Castro. So we were required to attend that seminar. Automation really helped, Your Honor, because that will replace the manual taking down of notes by taking down the testimony of witnesses through the computer. If you want a correction, if you want to know what is the statement of the witness, you just rely on what is printed or what is taken by the computer. That will really expedite termination of cases, Your Honor.
News reports say that you are close to Justice Lucas Bersamin. And in fact, there are several photos of you together in different social media. How does it feel going against the top post with your close friend as an applicant for the position of Chief Justice of the Supreme Court?
That's a good question, Your Honor, but I will start answering a question during our RTC days in Quezon City. What happened is that I was unknown to Justice Bersamin, but he was older by 3 years, I think, by me, and he was his station was Branch 96, and my station was Branch 95. So the rooms were beside each other. And because of what I experienced from Judge Caliejo, so I applied for the experience. So I do not go out from my courtroom. Justice Bersamin also does not go out from his courtroom. So we always take lunch together. And there were humors, they would say, sino ba sa kanila sa dalawa? That started the friendship. But you know, Your Honor, when we meet on lunchtime, we discuss jurisprudence. Because he's an expert in procedure, and he considers me also good in criminal procedure and criminal law, and we make exchanges. Now, about competition with two friends, I recall, when I applied for the position of Sandigan Bayan, and Justice Bersamin applied for the Court of Appeals, a question was asked by the former Chief Justice. Are you not competing with each other? He said, No, sir, because he's applying for the Court of Appeals, I'm applying for the Sandigan Bayan. Now, we have many things in common, actually, because during our time as RTC judges, he was chosen, no? I hope I'm not selling him. But he was chosen as an astounding judge for best decision in writing in 2000, both in criminal law and civil law. So they were saying, oh, talo ka nung friend mo. Sabi ko, he's better than I, so why should I envy him? And you know what happened the next year? I was chosen as most outstanding, one of the outstanding judges during the 100th year celebration of the Supreme Court. And the next year, we were both outstanding judges in judicial excellence. I was appointed, I think, in the year 2002 to the Sandigan Bayan. He was also appointed to the Court of Appeal in the same year. I was appointed in the Supreme Court January of 2009. He was appointed April of 2009 as a Justice of the Supreme Court. Now that there is a vacancy of justice, so we are here again. Whoever we be appointed, Your Honor, we have to respect. I see him as a competent and ready to assume the position of the Chief Justice. I hope that is the same way he feels about me. So that's my answer, Your Honor.
And why should you be chosen over your colleagues, Justice?
How is that, Your Honor?
Why should you be chosen over your colleagues? We have this Associate Justices, Teresita de Castro, because Bersamin.
Oh, yeah, I will.
About Andres Reyes Jr.
I cannot speak about Justice Andy Reyes because he has only been with the Supreme Court for less than a year. But I can talk about Justice Tess de Castro and Justice Bersamin. I know him since we were judges in 1994 up to the present. I have known Justice Tess de Castro since 2002. For a time, she was my presiding justice. And in fact, when she left the Sandigan Bayan as presiding justice, I was the one who replaced her. So I know her work ethics. I know their work ethics. Both of them are capable and competent to lead the Supreme Court, Your Honor.
You started and ended your ponencia in the case of Ocampo versus Enriquez with respect to the burial of the late President Marcos. With the need for closure and moving on. Considering the events that transpired after that decision was promulgated, do you think the Filipinos found closure and the wounded families of the dead and injured by martial law were able to move on?
I hope that issue has already been buried, Your Honor, because if we do not bury that issue, then we cannot move on. And I still believe that whatever is the past, we have to move on. We will not improve as a nation, Your Honor, if we do that. That's why I said, I put that as the last part of my ponencia as a reminder to those who will read my decision, that there is a need to move on. We cannot live in the past, Your Honor, on the past. We have to move on. And I think we are moving on. The issues now are not about Marcos. There are now so many issues other than the issue of burial of the late Ferdinand Marcos, Your Honor.
Do you think it brought unity to the country?
I think so.
In what way?
Well, we do not anymore receive or hear about complaints about the burial of the late President Marcos. We are now focused on the issues confronting the nation. Unlike before, Your Honor, before his burial, I believe there were so many issues unresolved during those times.
Peralta, am I correct to say that you buried your frustrations when your wife, Justice Fernanda, has not considered for the presiding justice of the Court of Appeals?
It was not actually a frustration, Your Honor. It was actually knowing what's the truth. That was my point. Because I did not like that others will suffer what my wife suffered when the spouse is really a member of the court. And what about those who applied, and who have no connections? That was my point. In fact, I do not harbor any ill feelings. That's my nature. even in the Supreme Court. That's why sometimes they call me as a joker, which is not correct. I'm a pacifier, and Justice Mendoza can attest to that. When the discussions become intense, they always look for me, and if I'm not around, they're not happy. So that's how I live. I'm starting to forgive them, Your Honor, because I already discovered the truth.
Had your wife been the presiding justice of the Court of Appeals, and now you're applying as a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, don't you think it's...
Yeah, I will answer this way, Your Honor. The man is always above the woman. So if he becomes the presiding justice of the Court of Appeals, I can reverse her. I can reverse. In other words, there will be no conflict. There will be no conflict, Your Honor. I hope.
Aretha, going back to your properties, from the questions of Tony Cayosa, that then you fully explained how your income increased. About based on the certification from the government agency concerned, it appears that there are several other real properties in the names of spouses Diosdado M. Peralta and Fernando Peralta, and some in the name of Diosdado Peralta. We have this one property in Muntinlupa. Do you have a property in Muntinlupa?
I have two, Your Honor. The first one was acquired in 1993. We were both working in the Department of Justice in Katarungan. We paid out installment for 10 years. I was a fiscal and she was with the OSG. So we availed of the low-cost housing or low-cost lots from the Katarungan that's beside the National Bilibid. The other one is we bought an installment basis sometime in 2015, a piece of property, small lot, Your Honor. It's only 165 square meters. These are the two lots that we have in Muntinlupa, Your Honor.
But do you have also a property in Las Piñas?
Yeah, because, you know, I will, you know, Your Honor, our subdivision is very unique. Our subdivision is composed of three cities. One part is Parañaque City, the other part is Las Piñas City, and then the other part is Muntinlupa City. So some of our properties are in Parañaque, where we have a house, a modest house, consists of three lots, because when we be transferred, because we were renting an apartment before, and our family was growing, we looked for a house somewhere in the south. And you know, the house was only 2.8 million. It is a small house consisting of 204 square meters, but there are two titles there. One is 75 square meter, the other one is 180, but this is one cut. Then in 2001, my neighbor, who owns a vacant lot near my house, sold the property to us on installment basis. And then we were able to pay her within 2 years. No? And then we put up an extension, you know, a bungalow extension and a garage. And then in 2006, because I was active in the association, a lawyer from federal land called me up. I was in Sandigan Bayan. That was, I think, 2004, within those years, Your Honor. Then he said, "Sir, we have a lot in federal land. We're not anymore advertised for sale." "When, who are you?" I said, I was your former student at the College of Law, UST. Why not buy it at 6,500 square meters? So I bought it. So that house now, in 2006, because the old house, it is an old house that we bought through a loan from the GSIS. It was a true loan. It was a loan from the GSIS in the amount of $2 million. It was already old, and there were a lot of termites. So my friend said, why not improve or renovate your house? So we started renovating the house in 2006, and then the extensions, we made it appear that it consists of one house, but actually these were extensions that we had when we bought these properties. So if you look at the house, they think that it's very big. It's only 600 square meters, but consisting of three titles now. And then in 2012, in front of my lot, I think we all of our lots were priced at 6,000 to 6,500 square meters. No? It was very cheap at that time in Via Pons Paranaque because we did not have water. We buy water from trucks. Now, in 2010, when water was already connected to our subdivision, the price of lot went up by 12,000. So I bought a lot in front. It so happened that the owner of that house is the client of my brother-in-law. He said, Manong, you buy that property now because someday that property will now be per lot, will now be more than 12,000. And now it's now 15 to 20,000 per square meter. And then because our children are very young, we do not want them to enjoy a life. We want them to enjoy a comfortable life. And I told to my wife, we start buying properties, even on installment basis, within the subdivision. So that's why that part in Las Piñas is actually part of our subdivision. It's not far from our house. That's why we have a lot in Las Piñas, Your Honor. But that's also bought through installment, Your Honor.
Peralta, you have already denied the rumors that you were announcing that you will be the next Chief Justice. However, I still hear some of these rumors until now. Does this mean that it is true?
Modesty aside, Your Honor, I'm not like that. I am not like that. That's not my character. Mm-hmm. I always believe that your fate belongs to God. I cannot go out and say I will become the Chief Justice because supposing I will not be appointed, what will be the face that I will show to my friends and you? I think unlikely of me, Your Honor.
Thank you, Justice Peralta, and good luck. It's already past 12.
Yes. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Judge Ilo. We now go to Justice Jose Mendoza.
Okay. Good noon, Justice Peralta. I intended to ask about the revival of the res ipsa loquitur doctrine, but it was already covered, and also the adoption of the continuous trial rule on civil cases, already covered. You mentioned earlier that you have a reputation of being a joker. Can you expand on that?
This is what my friends told me, that there are some rumors or reports appearing in social media that I'm a joker. And I take that statement that as if I have done nothing in the Supreme Court, then that I'm a joker. And that I'm not supposed to be a Chief Justice because I can do the Chief Justice because I'm a joker. What I know of a joker, Your Honor, is he's not a doer. He only jokes for the purpose of jokes, and he does not do anything. I think that's not me. As I said a while ago, Your Honor, I'm proud to say, modest aside, that I think you were there in 2017, we were in Baguio, when we had our session in Baguio, and I was surprised when the former Chief Justice announced that after all pala, Justice Dado is the top performer all these years. I think you remember that. That is not a joker, I think that's not a joker. In 2010, Your Honor, in 2009 to 2010, I had the privilege of sitting as member of the Rules Committee that drafted the rules on procedure, special procedure, environmental law. During the time of Chief Justice Corona, he also tasked me to become a member of the committee that drafted the rules on special rules on intellectual property cases. In 2014, I was the chairman of the Bar Examinations Committee, and the en banc tasked me to lead or to head the committee that drafted the rules pertaining to Sharia bar exams, which was approved by the en banc. In 2015, Chief Justice Sereno appointed me and tasked me to chair the committee that drafted the rules on revised rules on small claims. And then after that, in 2016, he appointed me as the chairman of the committee that drafted the rules on the continuous trial guidelines on continuous trial in criminal cases. Aside from those, Your Honor, the records will bear me out. Probably all these years that I joined the court, I never stopped accepting the request of the Philippine Judicial Academy to one of the regular lecturers. Now, if they say that I'm a joker, with all those things that I have done while I'm in the court, do you think I'm a joker? What I can only say probably is that I have a good sense of humor. Before, when the discussion becomes intense, I will always make it a point that everybody should forget whatever transpired during our heated or intense deliberations. I think I should be called a sense of humor, Your Honor. Not a joker.
Then earlier you also said you're a forgiving man and you have forgiven them after learning the facts. Can you expand also on that?
Well, Your Honor, one of the retired members of the JBC came to me one time, not too long ago. He came to me, and I told him frankly, sabi ko, if you ask yourself what you did to my wife, how would you feel? Diba? And I asked him. Then he started talking, but we did not talk about what ever transpired with the case, Your Honor. I did not like to talk about that anymore. So I said, you know, you're my friend, you're again my friend. I'm like that. You can get out of my room, sabi ko, and then sleep well. I have forgotten everything. The other three, there were judges, Your Honor. They came to me. They said that like this, we did not do that, and so on. Forget it. You may now go home and then sleep well. So that's it. That's it.
Those
I have forgiven everybody, Your Honor. That's past. My character is that, Your Honor, you forgive those who might have offended you, you forgive them and move on. You cannot turn back the time, Your Honor. Useless talking about the past. That will only cause you depression. That's why they say I'm always smiling. Probably the reason also why I look young, like what Senator Gordon said a while ago, Your Honor. Ganun ako eh. Wala akong kaaway. Even, you know that, there may be some discussions in the Supreme Court. After that, when we take our lunch, everybody laughs. Why? Justice Dado is there. Dapat ganun tayo eh. You know the truth, what for pa? If you know the truth, what for? Forget, Your Honor.
Those were my only questions. You can go home and sleep well.
But I'm not Chetro, Your Honor.
Thank you. Thank you, Justice Mendoza. I'm, again, very privileged to be able to ask questions of the good justice whom I've heard so many good things about. And certainly, it appeals to me that you are in the business of managing delay. And you're managing delay by continuous hearing of cases, something I advocated as early as 1980 when I was the mayor of Olongapo. But it would appear, how has that impacted on the backlog of cases? Oh, the Supreme Court alone, sir, has over 170,000 cases pending before it. Yeah. Sandigan Bayan has 673, which is something that's impressive. Yes. But would managing delay by way of continuous hearing cases, I'm sure it will create an impact.
Yeah.
Pero yan ang makakabuti sapagkat kung mapabilis, alam naman ninyo.
Alam mo, Your Honor, yung guidelines, I hope, can I talk in Tagalog, Your
Honor? Please,
so that the public can understand.
Kaya ako nagta Tagalog, dahil tumatawag
po yung there are two important parts of the continuous trial. One is the skills development. Yes. Now, this is the skills development teach the judges how to react to motions that will cause delay. I'll give you an example, Your Honor. There are prohibited motions in criminal cases, and one of which now is the judicial determination of probable cause. So we tell the judges that when you set the arraignment, then you set also the hearing of that motion. Because if that motion is a prohibited motion, there is no need to require the fiscal to comment. And do not be afraid. You will not be administratively liable. There will be no Rule 65 to speak of. And if you do that, you immediately go to the arraignment. You do not anymore reset the arraignment because there is a joint hearing of the motion for judicial determination and arraignment. So what do we achieve? We achieve a speedy arraignment because you cannot proceed with trial without proper arraignment. That's one, Your Honor. You know? It's actually skilled now. The most important one is this. We have to schedule the hearing of the cases during arraignment. It's like this. So if today is the arraignment, Your Honor, under the law, you have to terminate your trial within 180 days. So in that arraignment, you already fixed the trial dates. For the trial, we divide the 180 days into two. 90 days for the prosecution, 90 days for the accused. Now, if one of the parties later on move for postponement, that postponement should not be substituted by another day. Regardless of the reasons for postponement, do you have to finish? Those are the skills. Those are only one or two of the skills that we taught the judges. And it's very effective. Why? We cannot do away the reglementary periods provided for by law. The law was there since 1992, when our former Chief Justice was a member of the Senate, the father of the Honorable Cayusa. And we adopted some of those provisions in our rules. So how can we do? You cannot do away the 180-day period. So the only way to do that is the system. Now, the other one, Your Honor, is that we do not anymore allow written offer of exhibits. Because if you resolve objections on testimonial evidence, then the judge should immediately rule on the objections. That should be also true with the offer of evidence on documentary evidence. If testimonial evidence, objections on testimonial evidence can be done orally, then it should follow. Then it should follow that the offer of documentary evidence should also be orally. So there will be no more delay, Your Honor. These are the things that we thought. The other one, Your Honor, is that judges should follow strictly what the rules mandate them to follow. Because I always tell the judges that you are like, you belong to a religious sect, that we have a Bible. If you're a Catholic, you have a Bible. If you're a Protestant, you have a Bible. We judges, we have our own Bible, which is the rules of court. If you do not follow the Bible, the rules of court, you're not a good follower. What will happen to you? You might be removed. You might be disciplined. So why should you not follow the scheduling of trial? The trial should be heard. Trial should be set Monday to Thursdays, morning and afternoon. And then hearing days on Fridays. Why should you not follow the rule on archiving and the rule on
on the average inventory? Sir, yung 180 days ninyo, nare-reduce ba to something appreciable?
Yes, Your Honor.
Mga ilang araw po. Kasi po, kawawa ang tao eh. Nagbabayad sa abogado, magpo-postpone, bayad. Siyempre, alam naman ninyo yan, yung...
Alam mo po, Your Honor, it's like this eh. We have adopted a system that they can no longer go out beyond the 180-day period. So, wala nang rason eh.
Nakaposa sila
sa 180 days. Yun lang po problema namin yung drug cases eh. Mahirap pusasan yung judges ng 60 days from filing of the information po eh.
Speaking about that, sir, yung isang problema natin dito sa bansa, eh halos hindi napaparusahan yung mga pulis. O kung magkamisan yung mga pulis pang uhuli ng drugs, hindi na-appear. Nakakausap o maraming ginagawa. I have a proposal na yung police courts in every town, in every province must be identified para alam ng tao, ito yung judge na umahawak ng korte na ito yung fiscal na umahawak ngan para makikita kung talaga umuusad yung kaso. But yan ho ba pwedeng gawin dyan sa sinasabi niyong problema sa drugs? Because karamihan yan, drugs eh. Konting, yan isang dapat room for legislation. Yung gano'ng karaming judge, yung gano'ng karaming drugs, kaso na kagad, di ba?
Yeah, that has been the problem. Even when I was a fiscal and a judge, Your Honor, how to guard against the, what do you call this, the dissipation of those drugs that yes. are actually, they do not present the actual drugs confiscated. That is beyond the power of the court, Your Honor. It's more administrative. It's more on the part of the police agencies and probably the Department of Justice or Department of Local Government. We cannot do anything because what is offered and identified during trial, that's all.
But as a Chief Justice, when the time comes, as your Chief Justice, what do you do about that if you see that that's a barrier na dapat ma-overcome? I'm sure through the Judicial Bar Council, where you have congressman and a senator, maybe you can pass on some of these suggestions para ma-aprobaran sa Usgado, sa legislature, kung yun ang problema. But to my mind, I like your spirit about being focused on managing delay. And being focused means talagang tuloy-tuloy dapat. Pagka may nakitang bara, hahanapan ng agad ang paraan, hindi hihintayin.
Tama po.
So, how do you propose to handle all these things, Your Honor?
Actually, Your Honor, I was reading your 9165, RA 9165. Nandun lahat yung ano eh. Nandun lahat yung provisions eh. How to arrest or this or how to go about all of these shenanigans of the policemen. Walang nagpapile eh.
Hindi nga ho, nawawala pa evidensya o di kaya naman nag-expire.
The court can only come in when the case is already filed. Eh. That's beyond our jurisdiction. Eh. You will be encroaching on the power of the executive, Your Honor. Eh. Nandun lahat eh. There's a provision in the revised penal code, Your Honor. There is only one I remember where policemen were convicted of the crime of qualified bribery. And that law was introduced as early as 1994 when Republic Act 75-69 took effect, where the law says that if police officers or any agents, you know, and those who prosecute cases fail to file or prosecute persons arrested where the penalty is reclusion perpetua to death, then they will be, for a consideration, then they will be liable for qualified bribery and they will suffer the same penalty of the penalty to be imposed to those who commit the crimes. Iisa pa lang ang nakumbik yan, Your Honor.
You know, is there any, again, monitoring of cases being done to pinpoint, sabay-sabay yan, eh, police, fiscal, husgado. Kung mayroong ganong monitoring ng mga cases, malalaman natin kung saan.
I think we have monitoring, Your Honor. But what
I'm sure
all,
there is, pero hindi nga ako ginagawa eh.
Mayroon monitoring. What they can only do probably is what, as we did when we were judges, is that we sense that there's something wrong. During the time of Senator Lacson, he was the general at that time, we always give him a copy of our orders that this policeman did not appear. The next day, Your Honor, that policeman were already assigned in Mindanao eh. They have to appear because if the cases are dismissed due to absence of the policemen, the office of the PNP will be served with a copy of our orders. The next time around, Your Honor, the policemen are no longer.
That is one of our proposals. Na talagang pagka nililipat yung police, eh, babalik dapat kaagad para humarap dahil na kung continue series of cases.
But this one, Your Honor, dismissed na.
Then dismissed na.
Because the accused now will invoke his right of a speedy trial. We cannot do anything now. So we have to dismiss. So what are we going to do? We have to look for the policemen. They should suffer the consequences. That's all that we can do. Eh. But to go beyond that, I think it's already...
But isn't leadership supposed to be that, whether you're in the judiciary or you are a legislator or you are in the executive? You have to take it to the next level in the PUBA. Okay. This is a hearing to find out who are the best competent to become Chief Justice. Okay. I just want to know, if you have those problems, how would you approach it? Would you approach
Your Honor,
the president? Would you approach the legislature and have a meeting with the Senate president and the Speaker of the House?
I think Your Honor, what we should do is to have a summit. Summit among prosecutors, among judges, and among those who are involved in the enforcement of our drugs law. And then let's come to an agreement. What should be done? But I think that should be done, Your Honor, because I think the laws are already there. They are not only being implemented, Your Honor.
Isn't that
sufficient
the perennial complaint? The laws are already there, but hindi naman pina-implement.
Yeah, probably because that's why I said, Your Honor, my suggestion is that probably we could have a summit. And then summit among prosecutors, judges, and also enforcers, Your Honor.
In five pillars.
Yeah. We have been doing that, actually. We have been doing that.
Pero
actually. Well, we have to do it regularly, Your Honor. Sometimes the problem is who will spend for the food and hotel accommodation.
Who will spend for the food? I hope you're joking.
No, Your Honor. No, we do not have resources. It's good that we have developmental partners. I think even the JBC know that. The developmental partners like the Abaroli, Asia Funding, and Gojas, they are the one helping us with all these seminars.
All right, I'll go to another point. The other point that I'd like to ask you is, what is your take on the matter of, you know, there's so much gasoline expended in terms of parang gasolina sinusunog, no? Ang dami-dami yung kinakaso na malalaking tao, yung kala Marcos cases. Wala naman nangyari. Tumagal yung kaso, tapos wala nangyayari. Tuloy ang bintang, either nabili yung husgado, o nabili yung piskal, o nabili. And to my mind, that is the one of the threats to our judiciary, to our country, in fact. Na pagka pumalpak tayo, wala talagang focus, walang attitude na kailangan mabilis, kailangan flexible tayo, yung mga ganyan. Mayroon akong 5 Fs kasi, yun ang sinusunod ko pag napapatakbo ko ng gobyerno o ng anumang hinahawak ako. Pero the scorecard is very woeful.
Yeah.
Very woeful. Ano ang magiging attitude ng isang Chief Justice sa mga bagay?
I think the number one solution there,
five pillars again.
We have to avoid delay. Delay in the disposition of cases, that's the solution, Your Honor. We are very fast and then you render fair judgment, I think nobody will complain. Kasi ang tatagal kasi ng kaso, I was in Sandigan Bayan for 7-8 years.
Yes.
When I left the Sandigan Bayan, there were still PCGG cases. As fair filed as early as 1988 and 87. It's good that my presiding justice then and my chairman was Justice Tess de Castro.
Pero it would be people like you, sir, siguro yung mga katagdan ninyo, nasasabi niya, closure, wala eh. Para ang tingin ko niyan, sinasabi ko rin sa Senado, no? Na wala tayong closure, di ba?
Yeah, but if you are fast, Your Honor, kaya nga minsan, nagdududa na, that's why nagdududa ang tao.
Talaga.
Kasi masyadong matagal eh. And then when you come up with the decision, hindi na sila naniniwala yung nang tama eh. But you come up with the decision as early as possible, you comply with the period, wala nang masasabi ng tao, basta your decision is fair eh.
Of course.
Yung delay talaga ang cause ng delay.
Of course, when you're Chief Justice, I can be assured, or we can all be assured that managing delay will be a priority.
Yeah, yes, Your Honor. In fact,
because I heard that from Justice Serena also last time.
In fact, Your Honor, some time ago, I proposed to the Enbank that we now had to come up with the amendments of the rules on civil procedure. Masyado na matagal ang civil procedure. Ang suggestion ko, and then Justice Tony, our acting justice, agreed with me. Let us make all pleadings na, evidentiary na. No more allegation of ultimate facts to constitute
a complaint.
Cause of action. Statement of fact na. And then attach the evidence that you want to attach. And then attach the affidavits of the witnesses in the complaint. And then the answering party, likewise, will restate his defense. Attach the document in support of his defense. And then attach the affidavit who will testify on that.
I like that.
You go to pretrial, Your Honor, what will the judge will do? You will even go, you will do away with the modes of discovery. Walang gumagamit ng modes of discovery.
Yeah, I was about to ask you that question. Wala, yung modes of discovery, gumagamit. Di ba ginagamit
yan? Walang ginagamit yan.
I mean, that is supposed to limit the trial,
yeah,
to make sure na bago kayo dumating, ando
yes,
na lahat,
di
ba? Hindi na hindi sa labas yan, pero pinapaliwanag ko lang.
Kapag
may abogado kayo, hingin niyo sa abogado niyo na para umikli, mag-modes of discovery na kayo.
Wala nang modes of discovery, Your Honor. Now, if you do that, my suggestion, if you do that, what will happen in the pre-trial is, wala nang gagawin, no more
correct,
issues. Eh.
Correct.
Then we will prohibit motion to dismiss in civil.
Di ba tayo masyadong technical sa ating rules of procedure?
Because we copied the rules from
correct.
America.
Correct. Hindi tayo practical.
Yeah.
In other words, it's about time that we revisit all these things. Na, kumisa kasi, that's also a failure of the legislature sa amin, or for that matter, even the law centers.
Yeah.
Pag in-address ng isang court, ang usapan, iiklian, eh lumalabas, yeah. Lalong kinukulit, lalong umahaba.
That's correct,
nagdadagdag,
Your Honor.
Nagdadagdag.
That's correct. If you follow that, Your Honor, during the pre-trial, no more issues to talk about. summary judgment. Do not go to trial anymore, or judgment on the pleadings. Do not go to trial
anymore. Kaya na ako tinatanong kayo bilang maaaring maging Chief Justice. Eh, pagka nagawa niyo yan, susunod lahat yan eh.
Yeah.
Pag nagsama ang leader ng tao, sinasabi lalabas ang galing eh.
Yeah. I was already advised by the acting Chief Justice to come up with a circular to form a technical working group and a committee to start with that. But it will take time, Your Honor, because you will have also to look at intervention, third-party complaint, compulsory counterclaim, permissive counterclaim, third-party complaint, all of this. All of this will be affected. But we can do that. Why not?
We must do it.
Yeah, we must do it.
Before you go on, I just will close by sharing a story with you. When I was mayor, inatake ho niya 1980 yan. Tinawag ko lahat ang fiscal, tinawag ko lahat ang judge, tinawag ko lahat ang police. Sabi ko, anong kailangan nyo gawin nyo para bumilis? Yeah. Alam nyo na ala pala ko. And I enjoyed that experience. Sumuli sa akin si Chief Justice Fernando. You are in the executive. You have no business tampering with the judiciary. So yung mga attitude na ganyan, dapat talaga, we must break those walls and make sure na, sinasabi nyo, I like the idea of a summit, have a regular summit, have a regular scorecard, and make sure that the performance of duty is paramount.
Yeah, thank you. That's correct, Your Honor.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you also, Your Honors. Thank you.